on clear space. If you can hear me, please give me a, a reaction, an emoji, or something like that. Thank you.
大家好，我是纽约独立运动的组织者之一Edward。纽约独立运动目前就在美国准备成立一支NGO组织，它的宗旨是弘扬纽约民族文化，促进纽约独立意识的成长，以及促进纽约民族自觉。山川异域，民属同风，独立建国，实现自由。我们在此祝大署民国五运长久。
Hello， 大家好，祝大家在会议中能够多交流，争取互相之间能够成真正形成接触中的政治力量。谢谢大家。
I'm John from the California Independence Party. We believe liberating California and other nations from the Chinese colonial empire is the only way to promote peace and freedom in East Asia. That's why we, people of captive nations, need to form a platform of collaborations. I believe that today's seminar provides a promising start for such effort. Let's walk together. The empire must fall.
Good day, everyone. It's an honor to be here today with Manish Mutsu. Speaking at this historical seminar, which is one of the first of its kind to fully organize by us, the independent movements that want to break free from China. It is a testament of the growing strength and the unity of us, the collective cause and the support we have for each other. As a member of the Ghanaian independent movement, we always strive to wake up the long buried memories and tell our story to the world. And I believe by standing together, we can do it better. So let's share our wisdom and struggle, and let us lift each other's voices and show them that true solidarity can only be achieved on the grave of the evil empire. Thank you.
Today we gather here to discuss a very important subject, the death of Deng Xiaoping and the prospect of a democratic East Asia. For too long, the world has failed to recognize the true color of Deng Xiaoping. A dire consequence of such misunderstanding is a superficial comprehension of China today that led to an unrealistic hope for a peaceful and democratic transition of communist China. The rise of Xi Jinping finally makes the world realize that the democratization of China has failed. However, this does not mean that a return to Deng Xiaoping era, if possible at all, is a viable option. Deng's opening and reform was a necessary lifeline for the survival of the CCP in the late 1990s and early 2000s. Once the CCP became wealthy and strong in the early 2010s, it doesn't even try to democratize. Instead, it offers the world Xi Jinping, the new emperor of the Chinese Empire. To fully comprehend the reasons behind the rise of China's imperialism today, we need to re-examine Deng Xiaoping. He was, throughout his life, a ruthless communist who was responsible for the death of more than 10 million people. He orchestrated the Manchurian genocide in the 1950s. He murdered thousands of democratic protesters in the 1980s. He robbed the freedom of more than 7 million Hong Kongers. In the end, he left the world with a more aggressive China that is now more than ever ready to challenge the international order. This is why this conference is so important. At the end of this conference, the crimes committed by Deng Xiaoping will be revealed. The true nature of the Chinese Communist Party will be shown. The ambition of the Chinese Empire will be identified. More importantly, the bubble that a democratic China can be achieved will be bursted. You cannot have a democratic empire. You can only disintegrate an empire. Only when the empire is disintegrated, could a variety of democratic states emerge from its corpse? Only after China's gone, could a free and prosperous East Asia be achieved. That is the goal of Basuria Association. That is the goal of Far East Freedom Youth League. We hope to take this opportunity to share this vision and commitment with our audience. Now please welcome our first speaker, Mr. Tenzin Namjoo.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. From International Tibet Network.
Yes. Before I start, I want to state what a wise man once said. The world will not be destroyed by those who do evil, but by those that stay silent. Silence is complicity. Good afternoon, my friends. My name is Thaw Tenzin Namjoo. I'm a local Tibetan here in Southern California. And I want to extend my heartfelt gratitude to Zonggilo for giving me this platform to say a few words. And also, I want to say thank you to the attendants, people that are here, as well as those speakers that are going to be coming after me. So, Deng Xiaoping, his legacy has been credited with growth and prosperity in China. But his legacy is tarnished, and there's a big stain on his legacy for the widespread corruption in his government, CCP. And also the widespread crackdown on human rights and democracy. Under the leadership of Deng Xiaoping, the CCP cracked down on political dissent. There were widespread persecution of religious minorities and political dissidents were incarcerated, tortured, with no fair trial. So one of the most significant discussions that we may get into today, and which is a big stain on the legacy of Deng Xiaoping, is what, under his leadership, did on June 4th, 1989, in Tiananmen Square, which is what we all know as the Tiananmen Square Massacre. Under his leadership, the CCP sent military troops, tanks, to crush peaceful demonstration by pro-democracy students and innocent citizens. As a result of that fateful day, thousands of innocent students and civilians perished. This shows the level of how sinister Deng Xiaoping could get. During those times, all the political dissidents were incarcerated. Human rights was violated all over, and there was no freedom of speech. But Deng's policy goes far beyond the traditional confines of China. Its implications of what Deng's policies were in Tibet and East Turkestan were atrocious. I'm sure you know the way Deng's policies impacted the Tibetans and Uyghurs is so egregious. In 1950 and post 1950, after the Cultural Revolution, 1.2 million Tibetans have been killed as a direct result of illegal occupation of Tibet by CCP. More than 5,000 monasteries, which were the seats of higher learning of Tibetan Buddhism and culture, have been destroyed. Tibetans today do not have human rights. They do not have freedom of speech. They do not have freedom of religion. It is even criminal to even possess a portrait or picture of Dalai Lama in one's home. Some of the Tibetans who speak against the establishment of CCP without getting a fair trial and other sham trials, they are persecuted and incarcerated, tortured, systematically tortured and raped. So in these trials, generally, the CCP is the judge, is the jury, and is the executioner. And CCP is responsible for what happens to that political dissident or somebody who speaks against the establishment. The situation in Tibet today is so desperate. Since 2008, when there was a big uprising in Tibet because of the situation in Tibet, 159 Tibetans have self-immolated themselves. According to Freedom House, Tibet ranks as the first, next to Syria, as the place with worst human rights record. Nearly 800 to 1 million Tibetan children are in colonial boarding schools these days. They are forcibly taken away from their parents and families and sent to these colonial boarding schools and preschools. And some of these children are age 4 and up, where the medium of instruction is in Chinese. So these children grow up in the future not knowing Tibetan language, religion, culture, heritage, and they are deprived of their cultural heritage. So this is, in a way, the CCP's leadership's plan of long-term plan to eventually sinicize the Tibetan population. And also, since 2013, the CCP, under the pretext of some healthcare program, have collected DNA samples in mass from the Tibetan regions as well as East Turkestan, so that they can build this biometric database to eventually be able to surveil on the Tibetans and Uyghurs. So thereby building this Orwellian surveillance state. more than 2 million Uyghurs are currently in what they call re-education camps. But in fact, what it is a place where the Uyghurs, the Turks, the Turkic Muslims, and the Kazakhs, where they are brainwashed and undergo systematic torture and rape. We stand here together as freedom-loving people, and we want to be the voice for millions of our brothers and sisters back home and represent them and fight for them. In conclusion, in Tibet, the impact of Deng's policies have resulted in heavy influx and migration of Han Chinese into Tibet, thereby marginalizing the Tibetans in their own home country. Tibetans have become essentially a minority in their own land. So I want to finally end this by saying that we as freedom-loving organizations fighting for our own rights, for our people, we must stand together in unison and try and dismantle this despotic authoritarian regime called the Communist Chinese Party. So we stand here in solidarity with all the organizations that are here in this conference to go against and fight the CCP. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. That's very powerful.
Cheers.
Our next speaker will be Isaac Fu from Basuri Association.
Hello everyone. 各位大家好。我今天是作为巴蜀独立会的代表，结合我的主题是巴蜀人应不应该为邓小平骄傲。Should the Basurians be proud for Deng Xiaoping? 大家都知道，邓小平是四川广安人，但是就是。我在这里可以先把结论放在前面。邓小平这个人，从他历史地位来讲，他首先是中共这一个恐怖组织的核心人物，也可以说是他最重要的给他续命维持他到现在统治的一个关键。然后从我们巴蜀的角度来讲，他即使他对于巴蜀人民犯下了特别的滔天罪行，这个还不仅仅是指他作为一个中共这个集团的一部分，就做在这个中共这个集团内部，像邓小平这样对自己的故土如此的漠视，甚至刻意的残忍的中共匪首，他应该也是能排到前几位的。从实际的影响力来讲，可能他是最大的一个，就是对自己的家乡比他更封闭的像彭湃什么的，没有机会像他掌握这么大的权力。邓小平对自己的家乡犯下的具体 的罪行呢，我们可以就是说一桩来看，其中最大的一件就是从1950年代到1960年代对巴蜀人民的大规模的屠杀，和最后以及引发了世界历史人类历史上极其罕见的大型饥荒，死亡1000万人的大型饥荒，从绝对的死亡人数来讲，它超过了蒙古人和张献忠。邓小平是这一人间浩劫的，可以说他是可以作为个人来讲，他应该算是第一号责任最大人。他是1950年代的对巴蜀所谓中共局境里所谓剿匪的直接负责人， 也是1960大饥荒的最重要的间接责任人士。1950年，首先是我们从他讲起，1950年因为巴蜀是作为被中共最后统治的最后征服的地区，他当时他到了回带着中共队伍回到自己家乡以后做的第一件事情什么呢？中共军队征服巴蜀是在1949年的年底，接近1950年年初的时候，那个时候本来已经是冬天，已经没有任何农业生产收获的时候，他们做的第一件事情是大规模的征粮。实际上因为这个国民政府在1949年的夏秋季已经征过一次粮了，他这个征粮相当于是直接把农民的口粮存粮从家里拿走，所以这件事情当时直接就引发了整个巴蜀地区大规模的抗征粮运动，然后在中共的语境里就被他们说成这是所谓的国民政府残余势力的土匪叛乱，而邓小平是最坚决最疯狂的推行这个征粮，是为了自己的政治前途，在中共中共集团内部的上升，不惜就是以饿死自己的这个故土同胞为代价。当时就有一份数字，我们会看到，就是说1950年一月起，他们又开始中共政权说我们征1949年的粮，实际上1949年粮已经被国民政府征过一次了。然后在这个情况下，当时有这个四川有一些地方的下面的一些官员给邓小平打报告说，我们这里征粮这个情况太困难，农民反抗情绪很激烈。邓小平的反应是对这些所谓反应困难的中共官员进行大规模的批判，而是说这个实际上在那个时候，然后中共给他这个案例，这个中共当时给四川下达的任务是第一年就让四川省出去要外调，所谓外调就是从农民那里所谓征粮食征出去外调20万吨的大米，而且这个指标在一年一年不断的往上涨，到了1958年大跃进的前面那几年，从1950年1958年这段时间里，四川省以前就是四川省的范围，巴蜀这个范围里的饥荒，散点式的饥荒在不断的发生，已经开始有出现饿死人的情况。尤其在1954年的时候，即使在最核心最富庶的成都平原地区，已经又出现了真的出现饿死人，甚至出现所谓的这个抢粮的一些骚乱。而当时的自然就秉承的，虽然邓小平那个时候已经所谓的调到中央去了，但是他就换上来了，这个时候他就换上来他最得力的干将，征粮中间征的最积极的一个头，就是大名鼎鼎的每个巴蜀人应该都不可能忘记的一个人，李井泉。然后到了这个事情，就是说是1950年他所谓的剿匪，就是1960年这场大饥荒的直接的可以说是他的一个前奏吧。他已经给当时的巴蜀的四川省，他已经在全国中共体系内部已经定下了一个基调，就是我们就是负责，就是你想要多少粮食，想要多少农产品就来我们这里拿，我们就是负责给你出的，我们不一定有最多产出，但是我们有最强的征收能力，能够满足你中共国家机器包括你统治核心那些大城市的任意需求，还有你出口是所谓打扰充胖子，你去出口粮食都可以从我们这里拿，所以最后就形成了一个畸形现象，就是在1958年之前，四川省巴蜀的外调粮食是全国第一大省。但实际上我们可以看到地形啊，虽然说巴蜀号称天府之国，真正附属的就是成都平原的一小块，我们本质上我们是一个山地国家，人多地少，人均耕地一亩，就是正常情况你不这样搞都有可能会有饥荒。而他在这个高强度的征发的结果，就是到了1958年之前的时候，实际上已经在大饥荒爆发的边缘了，有不停有零星的断粮饿死的情况，以及实际上他本身整个这个地方是没有多少储备的。然后到了这个因为1958年那个大跃进那一波的时候，李井泉在这之前他做了一些贡献，尤其是邓小平对他肯定，使他的在本身中共党内得到一个很高的政治地位提升。 所以他1958年这一波他当然是一定要赶上的，而他赶上能赶上这一波的也跟邓小平有非常大的关系，就是邓小平实际上后面那不是为了毛泽东洗白，但是可以说是实际在大跃进整个过程中邓小平是起了极其坏的作用，各种亩产万斤的榜样典型，还有各地所谓推的这种他以前在四川在巴蜀用过的这些从农民手里抢粮食强制征粮的手段，就是邓小平被他积极的推到了其他各地，所以李颖泉既然作为此中老手，那就更是要拼命的去表现。后面发生的这个事情可能具体我们就不说特别说了，他这个实际结果就是在本身整个巴蜀地区的粮食已经处于供应十分紧张在崩溃边缘的时候，他加大了极疯狂的加大了所谓征购粮食指标，最后的结果就是超过一千万人在这场饥荒中饿死了，其中包括我的一些家人，就是这个情况是这个实质就是形象，就是从我现在揭露出来的一些文章中，当时李颖泉跟所谓中央官他首先是跟毛泽东有沟通，就是中间的时候中共内部其实是进行了不停的几次摇摆，是不是所谓的太左了，我们是不是要适当不要征粮征得那么厉害，这样的讨论发生过几次，但是他得到的这么一个尚方宝剑就是毛泽东是认可他用的这个做法，另外直接当时作为这个中共内部的总书记，当然不是那个总书记，不是现在他那个就是一把手的地位，就的邓小平作为直接推进这些东西，给他在北京有一个强有力的对他的这些做法进行一个强有力的支持，所以最后的结果是最后首先一个结果是巴蜀人民大量的饿死，但李鼎泉自己甚至在这场饥荒过后重新中共所谓内部检讨七千人大会的时候，其他几个程度还没有四川省那么严重的省份的饥荒的发生饥荒的省份的领导们都背了一定锅，对中共领导的事，就他自己居然他还能稳坐在那里。当然他最后后面是在这个所谓毛泽东发动文革发动因为造反的时候被这个巴蜀人民利用文革造反的机会推翻了，但是因为有邓小平对他的各种的袒护，他在毛时代之后文革之后他的政治地位依然稳固，甚至还上升，甚至有一段时间就是毛邓小平跟他的私人关系之好，有一种说法是他们两家曾经差一点就结为亲家，就是邓小平用了这么一个人，然后一直在支持他办法饿死自己的家乡1000多万人，就这种人如果说他是我们就是说所谓的 the son of Basurians it's so ridiculous 谁敢说这个人说是如果说有人是跟任何一个人你把你家饿死那么多人你有这么一个亲戚你去跟他攀亲戚这个好像有点心太大了，当然后面他执掌了整个中国的权力之后，那么后面一些事情他整具体的经历的工作怎样的扩大中共的强化中共的镇压机器啊什么这些我们全国范围的都不用说，但就在即使他执政之后特别突出的在巴蜀本地也有一个很著名的事件，就是在1989年北京天安门六四镇压的同时间，当时的巴蜀人民也是受这个北京运动这个鼓舞和感召，在那段时间在主要是成都为中心的那大城市，在成都天府广场举行大规模的集会，然后在当地应该是成都是北京之外是镇压的最血腥最残忍的，当时有美联社记者拍到了就是在天府广场示威的学生市民被警察就是形容的时候分批拉走，他可能没有动用机枪坦克这些，但是很多人被就是拉走直接甚至被枪决，甚至有被直接活活打死的，就是成都的死难人数的数量级应该在数百人左右，就是比北京少些，但是绝对是京外各个城市里面最 最血腥的一次。就基本上可以看，就是说如果我们理一个从另一个角度来讲，把邓小平做的所有事情和八蜀这里发生的所有事情我们来理一下，就会发现八蜀人民运气非常之好，生出这么一个儿子，然后他所做的所有的这个暗示最大的一头都落到我们身上。所以就是我们似乎如果说让他为这么一个人物，因只是因为我们是同乡这个骄傲，这好像有点搞笑。然后从我们的红，我们最后总结得出一个可能是我们应该有的一个看待判断历史的一种方法，就是跳出所谓第一是跳出中共和中国这些，就是这种中国大一统叙事灌输给你的你的故土，你可能每个人都会爱自己的家乡，爱自己的故土，爱自己的同胞，但是你为他们这里出现的这些所谓的大人物，一些重要人物，你为他们感到骄傲，你觉得他们是你骄傲光荣，是因为第一他们做了更多有益于人类的事情，第二他们是真的对你的故土你的家乡至少是有感情的。这一点就像是如果一个人他对于生养自己的地方是漠视，甚至像邓小平，我可能说他甚至是怀有某种仇恨的。这个有人做过一些精神分析，说是什么他以前被他跟家庭，他跟他的这个后妈有什么不伦之情，然后这种八卦我们不说，但是总结来讲，就是这个人对自己的家乡毫无情感，甚至到仇视。那么任何一个人就是说是我们不是说我们那，因为我们那里出了个皇帝，他确实如果从历史。中国所谓的中国秦以后两千年历史里边，他可能是巴蜀地区出的第一个全国性统治者。不能因为出了这么一个大人物，我们仅仅就是从权力经营角度来讲，我们去为他感到骄傲。每个人看自己的评判历史、评判自己的选择的时候，有一个更加理解、更加本土的视角去看待他。这可能是我们这一次活动有时候想大家给大家长期希望构建的一种这个心理上意识上的一种意识上的一种导向。我在这里，谢谢。
Thank you very much. I think everyone who's born in Basuria or whose parents, grandparents who's born in Basuria,in one way or another, your relatives, your neighbors who were starved to death had something to do with Deng Xiaoping. Each and every Basurian today, either one of your relatives or one of your neighbor was literally killed by Deng Xiaoping. I think that is a very powerful thing. Thank you very much. Our next presenter will be Peter Tsai from Eurasia Independence Movement.Thank you very much.
我今天应罗主席邀请来讲一下这个，请我来讲一个关于邓小平的话题。我想了很长时间，邓小平好像已经淡出我们的新闻很久了，就我没有听到邓小平这个名字，其实有一段时间。按照共产党的历史的话，凡是这种高级别领导人死的话，大概每十年五年他都要有一次这种悼纪念之类的活动，但是邓小平好像死了到今年应该是已经25年了吧，我记得他是1997年死的，那么好像没有看到任何活动啊。 是当时邓小平死的时候，这个当时时任国家主席的江泽民还在流那几滴蛤蟆的泪水，但是这个江泽民死的时候就没有人给江泽民哭丧了，很遗憾的一件事情。这个是我们好像很久没有听到邓小平怎么样，可能是因为习近平非常讨厌他，习近平要开倒车嘛，要从改革开放倒车里开出来。OK， 我搜了一下新闻，我搜了一下这个，搜了一下关于邓小平的新闻，最近最后一次的新闻大概应该是在去年的大概十月份的时候，有一个14岁的富家子，然后号在晒自己的兰博基尼跑车，说，然后呢，他说这个，还收到了什么邓普方给他写的字还是写的信，然后说他管邓普方叫爷爷。然后引发了一大堆猜测，认为这个人可能是邓小平的某一个第四代的后代或者怎么样。然后呢，其实这个新闻不太可信，这个新闻大概在网上存在的也就24个小时不到的时间，但引发了大家很多的不好的回忆，因为刚才说过，邓小平慢慢已经被大家遗忘了。但这个新闻其实搜到这个新闻的时候，大家突然又想到一些事情，想到邓小平他们的家族以及他们的家族发家致富的历史，这是他的，这是他的家族 family tree， 这是邓小平，这是他老婆嘛，然后他大女儿叫邓明，他大女儿邓明，然后大女婿叫吴建长，然后这个吴建长是东方有色集团的这个创始人，东方有色集团负责什么呢？所有的有色金属，包括所谓中国能够卡外国脖子的什么稀土之类的东西，所有的稀土都是他出口的。都是由他负责出口的，你可以想象他有多少钱，啊，第二个就不用说，大家都认识这个坐在轮椅上的这个摊子，大家都认识，这个叫他创建的康华实业，他是可能是全中国最早的一批官导，就是你可以想象，所有你不能买不能卖东西，他都能买成了，然后所有你能想到的可以贱买而贵卖的东西，可以赚差价的东西，他都要插一手，啊，你们可以想象他有多少钱。刚才那个人，刚才那个那个小孩呢，说是管邓普方叫爷爷啊，不知道邓普方是高位爷，他是没有后代的，不知道为什么管他叫爷爷，可能是太监的干儿子这种关系啊。这个是他的女儿，第二个女儿叫邓楠嘛，邓楠和她老公生的孩子叫邓国瑞，然后那个吴晓辉啊，之前被习近平抓了，那个吴晓辉就是这个就是他的女婿，然后这个吴晓辉被抓了以后。他好像是罚款100亿，然后这个没收非法所得750亿，啊，然后就是说，因为我们知道这个罚没的钱肯定又是他总财产的一小部分啊，他的所有的财富，如果你粗略估计一下，大概应该在1000亿美元左右。邓龙和贺平，这邓龙是他第四个孩子，贺平是贺龙的儿子嘛。然后他们创建这个他的女婿贺平创建那个保利集团，大家知道保利集团是出口军火的，就是大炮一响黄金万两，它是出口军火的，你有的时候你在美国买到 AK 什么是就是他出口的。然后他们的孩子现在应该是在加拿大，邓主席应该是在加拿大。然后最后一个儿子叫邓志芳，他小儿子邓志芳本来是物理学家，他在美国学物理，已经在大学教书了。然后呢，他的太太呢是生物学家，两个人本来都在美国。然后邓小平把他们叫回来去一起搞关岛。然后他创立的叫四方地产，你听这名字就知道，就是全国各地四处去拿地啊，空手套白狼，然后跑马圈地。你可以想象他有多少钱。这是他们的儿子叫邓国立，因为这个人前几年还出现过，在新闻里出现过，是在某个地方当县委书记之类的，然后可能习近平不喜欢他，就把他，他就淡出政坛了，这样子。这邓家人，你可以粗略估计一下吧，大概这个家族能够控制的实际资产，应该在1亿美元左右 ，$1 trillion，差不多是。万亿就是一后面有12个零，这个所有的人对这个事情都是非常痛恨的。关岛这个事情实际上是89年六四运动的一个重要的导火索， 因为很多人最开始的诉求是什么呢？就是铲除关岛，铲除这个关岛，就像这个标语里写的嘛，请问邓小平，我孩子在绝食啊，你的孩子在干什么？当然在捞钱。然后这个特权导致腐败，其实当时所有的人，就有这个共识嘛，这一件过于明显的事情，邓小平他们家孩子从某某地一张批条，然后就收到什么东西，然后转手投到市场去卖，利用双轨制挣钱，这个极其遭到民众极其的痛恨，这是民众是极其痛恨的，这个是当时的北京市民的一个组织，一个叫飞虎队，这个飞虎队里面成员主要什么人呢？是个体户，个体户其实是改革的受算是一种受益者。这是一种受益者，他们改革了以后可以脱离体制，可以自己挣一点钱，但是呢，他在脱离体制挣钱的同时，他感受到了体制给他们带来的更加巨大的不公平，所以他们组织起来骑着这个摩托车嘛，然后声援当时的学生，同时做出通风报信、传递东西的工作。这些民众后来被判得非常重，大概应该我看过一篇报道，说是他们组织者之一说的，他们在6月3号那天，然后被设了一个圈套，然后一网打尽，然后很多人都被判得非常重。后来呢，其实也民众也对他们不太记得这件事情了，他们觉得很遗憾。顺道插一句话，说北京市民啊，这个什么北京人是大家说北京人是什么样？有的一种调侃的说法，说这个一说北京人就是老北京猿人。不是的，老北京猿人不属于智人，跟现在人类不是同一回事儿。这不是北京人。还有就是说，北京人都是服务于这个权贵的，比如说服务于皇上的什么那种太监的角色啊，不是这样的。当太监的人不是北京人，当太监人都是那种特别贫困地区的，就人口多而资源少，然后吃不起饭，非常这个吃不上饭，然后没有办法才当太监。这是不说说太北京人太监，这也是不对的。还有一种人是说，像这种抖音网红，抖音上的网红，然后说这个老北京爷就是爷啊，这个每天一睁眼除了吃就是喝啊，这个地道啊，这个地道，但不对啊，这个是一个网，这是演员，他演这个是为了逗大家笑，然后这个不是这样，北京人不是这样。北京人的真正的形象，其实是在六四的时候，用身体，用赤手空拳，去跟荷枪实弹的士兵搏斗的一些人。这些人当时的下场，其实就是可以用肝脑涂地来形容，非常非常的惨。很多人被坦克压烂，然后在大街上一摊，就不能认出是谁。这是当时。当时拍那些照片，这个尸体躺在停尸房里，然后你从他的体态，从他年龄，从他穿的衣服一看就知道，这是市民，不是学生。这个才是北京人真正的形象。经历那件事的人，其实很难遗忘。我那一年只有9岁。我那年在上小学3年，因为太小了，没有上街。然后，但是我清楚地记得一些事情，就我邻居啊什么，他们听到枪声，然后他们不是说赶紧跑，藏在家里，他们拿着录音机，因为没有照相机，照相机有照相机，你也没有长焦镜头，你拍不到士兵开枪的场面。他拿着录音机去把枪声录下来，给以后的人听，留作一个证据。这是当时的群众的一些记载照片，这捡到了这个匪军开枪留下的子弹壳，迫不及待的给记者来看。这都是当时的一些名场面吧。从群众视角看到的民主化运动天人的世界。民主化运动里面有很多问题，就包括就六四这个事情，其实。从开始到最后结束，一到现在，拖到现在，然后它暴露很多问题。民众和精英其实是并没有真正的融合。你在天安门广场，你要进入广场的那个游行学生那个圈，你要出示学生证， 然后民众其实不理解精英，什么叫宪政，什么叫宪法，什么叫民主，这个民众其实不是真正理解这个东西。那精英呢，精英害怕民众，精英没有办法真正煽动民众，因为精英的话语民众听不懂，然后没有办法让民众听懂。如果你把民众煽动起来，你没办法控制民众，这是一个很大的问题。精英来自于帝国的各地，来自于中华帝国各个地方来到北京读大学，然后他们和北京的市民其实仍然是有隔阂，这不是民众，是民众来自于市民嘛？这是北京的各地的工人之类的普通的群众，精英归属体制内，然后民众是属于游离于这个体制之外，就像刚才说的飞虎队那些人，其实是个体户，但他们有点钱买了一辆摩托车，就仅此而已。他们游离于体制之外，就是说这个体制对他失去了约束力。但同样另外一方面呢，就是精英和他之间也缺少一定的联系，就是比如说还有一些问题，比如说精英宣传的是什么？和平理性非暴力。我们记得当时有一个名场面是，在金水桥上，应该是刘晓波吧，有人把一支枪给他，他把枪在金水桥的那个桥栏杆上把枪砸断，因为说我们不要暴力，我们要和平。民众很多是勇武派的，就是拿着一瓶汽油就敢去跟装甲车对抗的人。最后结果是什么呢？精英普遍看得比较轻，就是说学生运动领袖那些个通缉名单上的人，其实他们看得没有普通的民众看得重。共产党对民众下手非常狠。六四事件的最后一个出狱的人应该是2016还是2017年出狱的，如果我没记错的话，他叫苗德顺，他是河北来北京务工的工人，他可能是整个这个运动当中阶级地位最低的一个人，就是最地位最低的一个人，然后他判的最重，他在监狱里面待了如果2016年出狱的话，他待了27年，然后已经严重的精神分裂。最后一个问题就是说，精英我们现在仍然寄希望于改良，期待有一个民主中国出现，民众不厌倦。我实话实说，民众不厌倦。新思路是什么？我们现在讲一讲新思路。这新思路其实很简单，就是彻底的解体。因为共同体越小，精英跟民众的距离就越近，你做事情越好，越容易做。这是我的祖国优越，我希望他能够真正独立起来。这是大家看到吧，我标一小旗子在这里，这是我的东西。具体如何实现独立呢？我想留到后面几句后面演讲人来。今天时间比较多，我就讲到这儿，谢谢大家。
I didn't know that before, and I learned a lot, and thank you very much. Next speaker is a Hong Konger, but he couldn't be here today, so I will read his speech instead. He is from the Support Hong Kong Independence Movement. I'll pull up the sign of the organization right now. Yeah, the following is his speech.Hello everyone, I'm Yong Jin, a representative of the Support Hong Kong Independence Movement. 26 years ago, Deng Xiaoping died. As many people know, he had one regret before his death. That is, he did not see the so-called handover of Hong Kong. However, I would like to add another story. It took place in 1983. In this year,
the second round of negotiations between Britain and China on the Hong Kong issue took place. In this negotiation, Deng Xiaoping made a very scary threat to Britain, saying that even if it meant to take back a deserted island, he would take Hong Kong completely. Such a threat actually made Britain back down, and to some extent, determined the fate of Hong Kong in the future. After this incident, three Hong Kong representatives went to Beijing to meet with Deng Xiaoping in a last-ditch attempt to fight for the fate of Hong Kong. But what did Deng say in reply? He said that the Hong Kong people were not qualified to take part in the negotiations. The negotiations were entirely a matter between China and Britain. Please think about carefully how Deng planned the fate of Hong Kong. He would even want a deserted island so he could occupy it. What does a deserted island mean? It means that the prosperous city on Hong Kong Island would be completely destroyed. The people of Hong Kong slaughtered, imprisoned, or expelled. It is just like what China's doing to the Uyghurs and Tibetans today, or what Soviet Union was doing to the Ukrainians, Chechens, and Kazakhs. What Nazi Germany to the Jewish people. This is what he really thought. The genocide of the Hong Kong people was always one of his options. But what do many people still have illusions about China think today? They say that Deng Xiaoping was somehow different from Mao Zedong or Xi Jinping. They say that Deng Xiaoping represents a more open political trajectory, while Mao and Xi represented a close one. But is that really the case? We know that Deng Xiaoping made a so-called promise to Hong Kong. That is, one country, two systems. And what was the political system of Hong Kong who remained unchanged for 50 years? But is that true? In 1990, 7 years ago before his death, China and Britain agreed on a plan that a legislative council of Hong Kong would succeed the previous Legislative Council once China took over in 1997. Chris Patten, the governor of Hong Kong in 1992, carried out democratic reforms and decided to allow Hong Kong Legislative Council to be democratically elected by the people of Hong Kong in 1995. But what did the CCP do? They quickly abandoned the previous agreement with Britain, saying that the 1995 elected legislation in Hong Kong was illegitimate, and that they had set up a so-called provisional legislature, which was controlled entirely by the pro-CCP faction. This provisional legislative council does not have any popular mandate and is a puppet of the CCP. It was unquestionably an illegal organization. It was a rebel organization. And it was this provisional legislation that replaced the democratically elected Council of Hong Kong in 1997. Since then, the Legislation Council elections in Hong Kong have been manipulated by the Chinese government. And the Democrats and local factions never had an advantage. All of this undemocratic rule can be traced back to Deng Xiaoping. Having told so many historical facts, I think the truth is very clear. The complete loss of freedom in Hong Kong today is inseparable from the policies of Deng Xiaoping. The die-hard communist who subverted Hong Kong's political freedom with all his heart and soul. Deng was never a true liberal. In fact, his liberalization was only for the survival of CCP's totalitarian regime. All of his actions were only aimed at ensuring the long-term existence of the totalitarian regime. Therefore, he is very afraid of any real freedom, any real democracy, or any real national self-determination. The Tiananmen massacre that he orchestrated in 1989 is well known around the world. In addition, in 1987, 1988, and 1989, the CCP under Deng Xiaoping carried out massacres of Tibetans. From 1990 onwards, the CCP also carried out massacres of Uyghurs. Deng was responsible behind all of the massacres. His deprivation of genocide his deprivation of Hong Kong's people's self-determination, he his deprivation of Hong Kong's freedom and his plan to genocide the Hong Kong people all show that his brutality was the same, was on the same level as Mao or Qi. All of them are willing to defend China's communist tyranny with violence. And all of them are dictators who do whatever they can to defend the evil empire. The right to self-determination and independence is a God-given right of the people. And the people of Hong Kong should also have it. The history of Hong Kong has shown that China, as an evil empire with long tradition of authoritarianism, has always been threatening the freedom of Hong Kong. From the Qing Dynasty to the Chinese Communist Party, China has tried to subvert Hong Kong's freedom many times, and the people of Hong Kong have bravely resisted again and again to defend their freedom. These Chinese threats to Hong Kong reached an unprecedented peak after the emergence of communism. China is now an evil empire that combined communist and totalitarian ideologies. Mao Zedong, Deng Xiaoping, and Xi Jinping were all part of this tyranny. Hong Kong people's resistance to the communist tyranny reached its peak in 2019 to 2020, when millions of Hong Kongers fought in the streets against the tyranny. These tyrannies, of course, were all indirect part results of the political actions of Deng Xiaoping. As a Hong Kong protester, I call on the world to realize the nature of Chinese totalitarianism. Whether it's closed or open on the surface, what they were trying to do is to maintain the continuation of China's hegemony over Hong Kong, to eliminate democracy, freedom, and self-determination of its people, and to promote China's totalitarianism. The role played by Deng Xiaoping in the fall of Hong Kong is an important example of this. Likewise, we the people of Hong Kong will continue to be at the front line of the battle against the Chinese tyranny, and will continue to fight bravely to reclaim the land that belongs to us. Liberate Hong Kong, revolution our times, Hong Kong independence, the only way out. And we thank you. Next speaker will be Mr. Wang Han. He hosted a hunger strike in front of Apple, which made national headline news. Now he's going to share us with his thoughts on this issue. Thank you.
Thank you everybody, and thank you Mr. Lord and for organizing this activity for us, and I'm really appreciate all your done for this stage to for me and all the people to speak out. And yes, let's just talk about Deng Xiaoping. Deng Xiaoping has a lot of legacy. We really talk about it before, and one of it named socialism with characteristics, socialism with Chinese characteristic, 中国特色社会主义, which just defined what CCP is right now. It's not only about socialism, but also about Chinese imperialism, which I really want to talk about it today. And because I will just use my own experience instead of some grand narratives, because that's what CCP doing right now. And since I first arrived in United States in 2019, I have been participating in different protests against CCP. These protests are organized by different group of peoples like Uyghurs, like Hong Kongers, like Tibetans. And I really remember that before I participate in Hong Kong protests one time in LA, I thought we were similar because I monitored the Hong Kong protests in 2019, and I was really motivated by them, and it's really inspired. And I really want to be part of them. And I thought it was natural to just talk with them and just to be one of them, because we share the similar values. We were on the same side of democracies. And we would walk on the street shoulder by shoulder here in LA to support the people in Hong Kong against CCP. But somehow it just didn't happen. When I protest with people in Hong Kong, in LA, I feel it was difficult to join their conversation, even if they were so friendly, they were so warm to me. Like when they talked about their lives and their jobs, their career in Hong Kong, I realized that I had never been to Hong Kong even one time. When they talk about Hong Kong food, I realized that I have never tried some authentic Hong Kong food before. And when they talk some Hong Kong music and Hong Kong movies, which I somehow familiar with it, but I just couldn't join their conversation because I don't know Cantonese. So yes, it's really difficult for me to be part of them, to be part of their communities. I know that I can feel their sadness from their conversations because their freedom and their democracies have been taken by the CCP. But also, I can feel something like I have never felt before, which I can hardly explain. Since then, I have, every time I just participate in different so-called minority groups protest against CCP in LA, I have the same feelings, such as Tibetans and Uyghurs. So one thing I have pondering so long is that why I cannot like be part of them. In 2022, when the Russia Empire invaded Ukraine, I just joined the protest in LA at the Santa Monica's against the Russia and Putin. And when I saw a beautiful Ukrainian girl crying while she just singing the song of the ballet of the Ukraine with his companions, I feel the pain from her. It's not only about the justice against the dictator, but also I feel the love to her hometown from her. So at that moment, I realized that I could not be part of them because I don't have the love to their own land. I can say I support them, but I could not say that I love their land. To some extent, I'm similar to them. We fight for justice, we fight for freedom, we fight for democracy, but from another angle, they also fight for their friend, their relatives, their kids, their language, their land, which they love. Yes, they fight for love in addition to justice. For that reason, maybe I will never be part of them because we are from different community. They have their own background. Yes, I can hardly say I love Hong Kong or I love Tibet or I love Eastern Turkestan because it's not my hometown and my community, which I have so many memories. The CCP is evil to deprive our own freedom and democracy, but also it's evil of its own Chinese imperialism to just destroy our religion, destroy our culture, destroy our own language, our dialogue. Since then, I respect people from different community more deeply. I know everyone's identity is important and should be respected, even if sometimes you cannot just completely understand their feelings. So during the hunger strike and the A4 revolutions, I always just invite different group of people. It's not only just show our diversity, but also let more like people from China, like me, pro-democracy students, to understand some people from other groups, their national identities, to understand their pain, their sufferings. So when President Law invited me to this meeting, I feel honored to join and appreciate the courage that his expressions to his own nationality. I was really moved when you said that you are fighting for your child and the next generations of Basuria people. Thank you so much for organizing this seminar again. And I will say last one word to all of you and to the Western world that we, the people of democracy, loving peoples, freedom loving peoples, we will never exchange our human right, our identity to some economic prosperity superficially like Deng Xiaoping. So yeah, thank you. Thank you.
因为临时来的比较迟，所以呢，就老师说让我先代表我们那个去国者研究会在这发个言。我今天来，我个人呢是在这儿来学习的，因为这个主题今天提到邓小平这个，包括那个各个那个就是各省独立的这些议题啊，我是最近才开始接触的邓小平的那个当然是有的，因为我是当年那个。学生运动的参与者，80那个时候我是当时的大二我们参加了长沙的那个就是学生的运动，只不过呢我是在不像要坚持到64那个时候，我们在5月30号就在那个学校的动员下，我们就已经回到了学校，已经正式上课了所以但是呢对我们这一代人的影响还是比较大的，因为我们那个时候刚才我们很多人都升华了，就是说提到了我们谈个人自由啊这方面的人的权利方面的呢，我们当年是意识不到，我们只知道很紧张，因为不论是从学校也好，还是从这个我们当年是有分配的，当我们那个毕业的时候那个分配的那个单位之后，不论是在学校还是在单位，我们这些在校期间还是在分配之后呢，我想应该不下5次吧，每个地方都是要求我们写各种检讨，就是说对这个我们在89学院中当中的反应，我们那个当然我们那个时候已经好多人分配的单位都已经否认我们参与过了，但是他们不信确实也不是事实，但是跟我们造成的印象是什么，我们很恐惧很害怕我们当然可能生活在我们现在我们大概生活在美国，慢慢习惯了这种自由，但是我们在那个年代我们觉得是很恐惧，因为从北京传回来的消息来说，那些就是不论是开枪啊坦克啊这些我们已经听到了，虽然在我们长沙我们没有发生，但是呢我们恐惧的心态，所以让我们先检讨，我们赶紧写那个害怕他们有更严重的后果跟我们导致，所以写得很诚恳我们生活在那个年代呢，我认为啊就习惯于恐惧，所以当慢慢社会也在转变，我们意识到我们在成长，意识到自由是我们人权的一部分的时候，这个可能没有生活在我们那个年代的你们这个年轻一代可能是感受不到，我们感受到现在的尤其来到美国之后的更加言论自由的这种环境是多么的不容易，所以呢那个我来到这儿美国之后呢，我就加入徐先生这个去国者先生研究会，也是受他的节目的一些感召吧，就是想多了解一些事实，像那个朋友谈到的一些历史我们对邓小平，你们今天一提里面提到邓小平，但是我作为个人来说对他是不是怎么了解，我只知道这个作为共产党这个整个体系我生活得很压抑，在当年的那个年代，所以呢那个 而且在受西方这些各种尤其去的多了的那些地方去了，你会觉得那个自由，人家活的是，就是像那个陈丹青说的，在大街上看到的是没有，个个都是没有受过欺负的样子，而我们呢，永远都是生活在那种压抑的一些环境下。所以呢，那我今天的这个，本来我是带着这个，就是说，由于说往前走的心态，就是说，哎，我们这种作为中国人生活在大陆的一个不自由的土地上，那么压抑的情况怎么改变？那作为这种各省的人，就是那种独立的这种运动，也许是一个我们叫做 way out 啊，就是也许是我们的解决方案。所以我想多了来听听大家的一些见解啊。所以刚才那位朋友说的很好，就是我们多学历史。我是来带着耳朵来听来学习的。我们去过这些现在研究会这几位都在这儿，我们呢大家都是在徐哥的带领下呢，跟各个那个协会呢都多交流，多了解一下，看看未来我们作为我们华人这个群体怎么能获得更多的自由啊，就是个体能获得自由，群体能获得民主的这个权利。好，这是我的一个简短的解说。好，谢谢。
Thank you very much. I think it's good to hear that the democratic movement, especially the mainstream trend of democratic movement, is now finally starting to realize that the disintegration of the Chinese Empire is actually the quickest and in many ways the only way to get democracy in East Asia. Thank you very much. Our next speaker will be Will from Far East Freedom Youth League. Thank you.
大家下午好啊，我是远东青的代表 Will。今天呢，我是在这里代表远东青和各位朋友来探讨这样的一个话题，就是叫做小中国主义和猪价的未来。这个听起来这个题目是不是有点学术，不是很好理解，所以我起了一个大标题，叫做我们一定要重蹈俄乌战争的覆辙吗？这个问题为什么会存在呢？就我们可以接着往下看。今天呢，我们其实可以已经在座的各位都有一个共识，就是我们可以很放心的说，尤其是经历了新冠病毒的这个肆虐之后呢，无论是美国政坛还是我们在海外的这个广义的华人反对界也好，或者说是广义的民主运动的这个人士也好，包括新一代的加入我们的年轻人，一个新的比较体面的共识已经达成了，就是说中国的解体不再是一个敏感的禁区话题，或者说是一个政治不正确的东西，它已经变成了一个大家开始积极讨论的话题，并且越来越多的人同意并且支持西藏、新疆，或者叫做东突厥斯坦，甚至台湾，是有权利脱离中华人民共和国，或者是未来的民主化之后的中国获得独立的。那么，我们再看美国这方面的动向，其实不仅仅是中国未来的一个解体的问题，美国最近呢已经开始考虑俄罗斯发生解体，尤其是在近期，在乌俄战争结束，或者说在乌俄战争进行当中。发生解体，迅速出现俄罗斯解体的可能性。比如说美国著名的这个保守派的智库叫哈德逊研究所，就是余茂春先生供职的这个研究所，他们最近开始公开讨论俄罗斯的解体，包括解体的方式，美国的国家的应对策略之类的问题。与会的学者们一致认为，俄罗斯和中国呢并非民族国家，就是现代的民族国家，而是帝国。所以很多人认识到俄罗斯必须解体，所以也有一些学者说中国也应该和俄罗斯一样同时解体。这些话放在几年前的美国是完全不可想象的，说明现在这个风向或者说时势已经走到了这一步，就是不论学者还是政界都开始讨论中国未来解体的一个问题。那么所以对于我们海外的广义的民主运动参与者呢，包括独派在内了， 新的争论的焦点就变成了包括香港在内的所谓的这个汉人，或者说是关内的汉地十八省，是否应该进一步分裂为朱夏的问题。也就是说，你看我们这个图，如果说我们现在中国将来发生一些戏剧性的变化，共产党倒台，那么我们是先追求一个包就是汉地十八省在内的一个小中国的一个民主，和周围一些分裂出来的国家，比如说 Tibet、East Turkestan、Mongolia and Manchuria maybe。And include Taiwan， 我们是要一个这样的一个状态，还是说我们一步到位，直接把汉地十八省分裂为朱夏？袁东新呢，曾经有一位朋友，他是支持参与中国民主运动的，他曾经这样问我们说，我自己呢其实并不反对中国的不反对中国这个变成朱夏的一个可能性了，但是我有这样的一个问题，就是假设中国的民主化发生了。我们迎来了后共产党的时代，可能就是大一统和朱夏真正交锋的时刻了。虽然现在的新一代年轻反贼呢都比较倾向接受朱夏理论，但是至于实践可能要看到时候的局势。如果一个汉地十八省的民主中国的出现呢，我个人觉得是可以接受的，不知道远东亲的各位对这个问题是怎么看的。我的这个演讲呢就是试图回答这个问题，就是小中国和朱夏我们应该如何取舍，我们是应该先追求一个民主的小中国呢，还是直接一步到位，在关键时刻用一切可能的方式尽可能的让更多的朱夏国家出现，让留在核心的这个绿色的小中国呢区域尽可能的小。在这里啊，我不妨先抛出结论，第一，一个民主的小中国会让我们所有人都失望，第二，我们会重蹈普京俄罗斯和乌俄战争的覆辙，所以我们应该提前做好准备去避免这种情况的出现。为什么呢？这种说法呢其实是一个很严重的预测了，因此我们必须解释清楚。我们不妨假设在未来的东亚大陆以最大概率的形式形成了一个关内十八省的小中国和周边多个小国家解体共存的格局，那么中心的这个绿色的民主中国呢，不管它是青天白日旗的中华民国也好，还是旗子长得像 CCTV 以前的那个台标的那个机构也好，在这种情况下我们就会面临一个极大的考验了，就是中国民族主义的问题。今天我们的这个讨论的主角邓小平呢，他作为一个共产党其实和毛泽东一样不是很称职。为什么这么说呢？因为他们其实本质上还有一层面向，就是中国的民族主义者。邓小平有一句名言大家都知道，就是我是中国人民的儿子。你看他背叛自己的父老和巴蜀祖国去给中国人民当儿子了，对吧？然后反过来去屠杀巴蜀的父老。所以其实中国的民族主义是一个很强大的东西，它连共产党人都能洗脑，何况对于普通的民众来说呢？我们都知道中国的国耻教育嘛，它的一种理念就是说，它把自己的爱国主义是建立在一种屈辱和仇恨之上的。它不光是中国，绝大多数的民族主义其实都要有所谓的他者才能存在。中国选取的这个他者就是西方和日本。中国的核心利益就是反对西方日本过去对自己的一个不管是心理上也好还实质上的一个压迫，然后去维护国家的统一。这个我们很熟悉就不用多解释了。但是还有一种沙文主义产生的情况，就是因为自负。就我们有一句老话怎么说的来着，叫刚吃了三天饱饭就不知道自己姓啥了。其实人都是有这样的弱点的，这个不是中国的特殊问题。比如说一战前的德国和一战后的日本，也就是所谓的陷入了修昔底德陷阱，这个大家也挺熟悉的。就比方说图上左图这个很有代表性的言论，你看他怎么说的，其实这并不是共产党洗脑的结果，因为它是中国民族主义一个本来含义。中国的民族主义就是说中国自古以来是伟大的，只有近代清朝腐败加沉迷于天朝迷梦才搞得落后的。那么只要中国经济发展到一定程度，就会有民族主义的抬头，认为大中国根本没有必要再像过去一样养西方人和日本人的鼻息，扬眉吐气的时候终于到了。好了，扯远了，那么我们说回未来的情况。我们都知道对中国的民族主义者来说，国家尚未统一都是一种无法忍受的耻辱。那么假设民主后的中国发生了更进一步的分裂，那一定是一种更大的屈辱，尤其是和自己文化非常接近的部分如果分裂出去的话，就越发的屈辱。所以我们可以假设，如果满洲和南越独立了，那对中国来说就比西藏和东土耳其斯坦的独立更加令人难以忍受。所以呢，这些独立的国家 为了保护自己的独立地位，议会和西方、日本结盟和高度的合作，各方面的发展水平会远远高于留在核心区的这个小中国，甚至他们会构建出亚洲北约。整个过程就是可以参考现在东欧发生的情况。就也就是说，到时候的中国无论与否，政客利用和开发中国的民族主义是一种必然的结果。这个大家都不用去考虑这个事情会不会发生啊。有人说这个事情不是不会发生，只要有言论自由，那么有制衡，就不会有发生恶变。其实这个没有这么想当然的事情。这个民主的制衡可能会让这个过程慢一点，但是根本上还是起不了多大作用。这是我们今天看到的俄罗斯和普京面临的一个困境。民主的中国政府一定会反映出民意，最终试图用武力重新统一之前分裂的国家。有很多人会问，为什么这种制度的制衡会没有用呢？难道不是说在言论自由的情况下，民众会更接受和平主义和国际主义的观点，不用去军事解决问题吗？其实并不会。我们都知道，一个亲日的满洲国和中国是势不两立的，一个清英的继承陈炯明的南越国和一个继承了亲苏的孙中山的遗产的中国也是势不两立的。他们的存在和发展就是中国的耻辱，他们的成功和辉煌会映射出一个没有共产党的民主中国的失败，这会危及到中国本身的合法性。因此中国必须像普京一样来诉诸战争保护自己。那么战备的情况我们就看到了，整个西方世界包括我们在座的所有人都站在了乌克兰的一边，整个俄罗斯我是说到时候的民主中国啊，都会被战争毁灭。那么我们看看今天的俄罗斯人在做什么。在战争的当下，很多俄罗斯的有识之士他们是如何做出努力的，他们看到了问题的实质。今天俄罗斯联邦深重的问题和灾难，表面上它是俄罗斯民主的程度不够，但其实问题的实质是俄罗斯的民族发明出了根本上的问题，才导致它和西方为敌。俄罗斯作为一个国家，它生存状况非常恶劣，所以自由民主的程度当然就不可能达到西方的标准。允许我在这里用比较抽象的术语来总结一下俄罗斯和中国民族发明上到底出了什么问题。俄罗斯或中国的民族发明方式是帝国民族主义，而不是小民族主义。帝国民族主义的合法性或者说对民众的一个吸引力，是怀念昔日帝国开疆拓土和压迫征服别的民族带来的所谓的荣光。它对应到今日的现实政治当中，就是反对西方自由秩序，渴望建立自己主导的区域秩序和世界秩序。统一俄罗斯党的党魁普京曾经许诺俄罗斯人民说，给我20年还你一个强大的俄罗斯。俄罗斯人民虽然获得了自由，但是他们衷心希望俄罗斯帝国重新强大。但是帝国和自由毕竟只能选择一个，俄罗斯人民要挽救俄罗斯的帝国，就只能赋予普京更多的权利。而俄罗斯的所谓的自由派呢，他们既要大俄罗斯的荣光，又要自由，两头不占，那么在现实政治当中就一定会败给普京。毕竟反对普京在现实上就等于给俄罗斯诸罗斯的分裂势力包括乌克兰在内和西方做嫁衣。所以今日俄罗斯的困境，俄罗斯人也在思考和争取自己的出路，诸罗斯各国爱国者也在争取努力让俄罗斯和平解体。所以说俄罗斯问题的最终的解决终究是靠诸罗斯的独立，他们挖掘自己的家乡的历史，重建自己的记忆，完成新的小民族主义的建构，并且最终建立自己的国家，才能和西方主导的国际自由秩序兼容。所以说这就是来到了我们的结论，这就是为什么我们无法信任一个民主的小中国会给我们的家乡带来人权和平与发展。我们必须尽全力争取一步到位，让诸夏实现，以免乌俄战争的悲剧在东亚重演。好，谢谢大家。
Thank you very much for insight. We have a Mr. Mo, would like to say a few words.
Thank you.
Please come up.
Thank you everybody for letting me be here. I am no preparation.Be here. So, I would like to give thanks to President Luo for his hard work to let everybody here that are to discuss the future of China and let me to express my ideas. Thank you. And the former talker, your speech encouraged me to express my ideas first. And the second, my former talk is talk about the dissolution of Russian Empire in a new area that post-colonized of the Russia. And now we see the Ukraine war are continuing. I have make my post in front of the consulate of China and several 2 months ago. I make my idea clearly and simple that the great Ukraine war means that in the near future that the dissolution of China, the China Empire. So this is my idea. Here, everybody come here. We share the common wealth. The common wealth that we struggle for democracy, we struggle for freedom, even we struggle for the independence of the every nation. We, our own nation, Tibet, Ukraine, and Bashuria, even my own nation, maybe everybody not here, not even heard is I'm from Hainan, Iceland, the southeast Iceland in southeast. Of course, I gave our new nation and Hainan a new name. If in the future it will be called Jonglia, maybe some suggest that it could be called Jongland. thank you. Even a few days before, I made my on my Twitter that to correspond to my respond to the Chinese spy balloon over several democratic countries in the sky. So our clear is very my attitude is very clear that a peaceful South Sea need the free Cantonia, free Hainanese Iceland, and free Jonglia. So this is my opinion. Of course, we every day studied on our Twitter to study President Liu Zhongjing, and on his Twitter, he is our teacher. So we think he's also encouraged and give his smartest wisdom to us so we can study. And our former talker talk about the different way that unification will order in the future, the multi-East nations win, the two different ways. Of course, we maybe heard the phrase that the former prize winner, the Nobel Prize winner, Liu Xiaobo, he said one phrase that after his death, his friend make a book to publish his collections that is unification of China means slavery. So in short, I stress again that our hope and our struggle is that we hope to build, although it is hard strike or in the long term, that we want to build our own nation, even our new government, even it is still in exile today. So thank you everybody to give us, thank you everybody.
I think that message is loud and clear. Thank you very much. We're a bit out of time, so I have to conclude today's meeting. But I think this is a very productive meeting. It's a very, very productive conference, the first of its kind, to seriously, systematically discuss about the possible future of East Asia. East Asia without China. East Asia that can be multinational, that can be democratic, that can be free, that can enjoy prosperity and peace. Now, I would like to end this with, in my own language, my mother language, Basurian. 等下面那个人，他对巴蜀人的印象是，可能是其他地方人不能理解的，就是你如果说今天你到重庆和成都的街上去走，你随便点一个人出来，你问他，你们老汉是啥子样子的？你老汉长大的时候啥子样子的？你婆婆爷爷的外公外婆长大的时候啥子样子的？你们屋头饿死好多人，你们邻居死好多人。你去问他那些，你可以发现，在今天，在巴蜀任县区，没得一个完整家庭，三代人以上没得一个完整家庭。如果说二战期间让俄罗斯每一家都缺了一个盘盘，缺了一个席位的话，那么对于巴蜀人来说，邓小平本人犯下的罪行，比二战期间要大，他是。层层的饿死人，层层的杀死人，他破坏了无数的家庭，让无数的人妻子自杀，饿死了无数的孤儿寡母，然后他利用饿死那些人得到的政治资本，当上了中华人民共和国的一把手，这就是邓小平的人。但是我们今天不应该只关注到邓小平那个人一个人身上，我们要看得更长远，他对巴蜀犯下的罪。是很难再用城市人的标准去衡量，也是很难再用今天的标准去查判。但是为了避免今后，为了避免未来还有可能有像他这种出现，只有让巴蜀独立，只有让中国解体，只有让东亚恢复一个多国体系，才能够真正的避免像这种。我想那才是今天我们会议可以得出的所求。I think and that concludes my final note. Thank you everyone for being here. It's a great honor to have everyone. Thank you very much.
超级帅
！Thank you, thank everyone, thank you very much for coming. Thank you very much.
Thank you, thank you.